I'm going to say we're live.
Tyler says we're live. Well, let's go live. Andy Kendeigh along with Sean Callahan. Welcome to the new football season 2023. It is time for Nebraska football as we'll get you ready for the next half hour for Nebraska and Minnesota. It's a 7 o'clock kick. Our apologies on being a little tardy. We're having audio issues, so we're hang with us. But if you have any questions for us, fire away. So, Sean, let's talk, first of all, where we're at. We're at the luxurious Tom Place Suites in downtown Minneapolis and in the breakfast room. Did you take advantage of free breakfast?
Yeah, no.
No, you didn't.
I had my family here.
So oh, yeah, family man. That's right.
It's my wife Lisa's birthday. Okay. Happy birthday, Lisa.
Yes.
And we walked over, my daughter and I walked down to Starbucks and brought breakfast this morning.
All right.
So we got it was a brisk 59 degrees.
Gorgeous this morning. It felt like fall, didn't it?
It was like 7 a.m. when I was outside. It was just perfect. No wind.
That's awesome. Yeah. It's a wonderful day. And people wondering what kind of weather we're looking at for tonight. Chamber of Commerce. It's like 80 degrees, maybe 77, high 70s, dip down to low 70s by the tail end. Might be a little breezy, but you couldn't ask for better conditions. Let's talk about the team itself. What are your impressions, Sean, about how training camp went and how prepared this year's team is at this point going into their opener against Minnesota?
Well, it was as unique of a training camp as I can recall in my time covering Nebraska, just from the team living in the dorms for 2 weeks and then even having bed checks the third week. So Matt Rhule really maximized the time because during training camp, you get unlimited hours with your team. You're not under the 20-hour rule where you can only have 20 hours of practice, meetings, lifting, organized activity. You can do unlimited. And Matt Rhule really maximized those 3 weeks with his team by putting them in the dorms. And it wasn't just, you know, to make them be on campus. I mean, he wanted these guys to get to know each other, get to do things outside of football, just build that team chemistry and bond, once guys playing card games together. Mm-hmm. The other thing that was unique even from the start was they broke it up for 3 days where it was two separate practices where the first 60 guys went and then the next 60 guys went. So they really preached development, giving reps, an opportunity. It was a very physical camp. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, you heard Isaac Gifford this week, Andy, say, without a doubt, the most physical camp he's been a part of and not even close.
Yep. And they hit a lot. And, you know, yeah, there's risk to that. But I think, you know, aside from Marcus Washington, aside from maybe Teddy Prochazka, and we'll hear more information about Nick Henrich tonight, they came out of camp pretty healthy, right?
Yeah, I think the Maverick Noonan injury was probably one of the more significant ones. And he might have played as a freshman, some reps. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the Prochazka one's a blow just because you heard Matt Rhule say this week, because I've never really even seen Teddy practice.
Right.
Because he missed most of the spring with his shoulder recovery, and then it's been out almost all of August coming off retweaking a knee, but has started to practice. We could see Teddy in this game, maybe even in a tight end jersey, coming in as an extra blocker.
Okay.
That's something I'm looking forward to seeing how they come out, because I do think Matt Rhule wants to be physical, play with tight ends. With a fullback and just see how this team can play like that.
Now, how much is that in Matt Rhule's style, and how much of that is that really Nebraska's strength offensively will be running the football and they'll have to hang their hat on because of the receiver situation, and you'll probably have to utilize some of your strength, which is tight end and running back in your whole line, right?
It's a little bit of both. Right. I think Matt Rhule, if you study his coaching, he's developed his systems to fit where he's at and what works. He's not going to say they're going to adjust to me, as we know.
Right. That didn't work
out. That didn't work so well with some other coaches around the country and here, obviously. You know, when you're in this league, you got to build to the Big Ten. Mm-hmm. And I think he's building to the talent he has on the roster into the Big Ten Conference. And he said this, I thought it was interesting, one time he said, the people here want to see us play a physical brand of football with tight ends, fullbacks, downhill running. They're the ones that pay my salary.
Right.
I'll play the brand of football that people in this state want this team to play too. I'm not going to try to come out and be gimmicky and say, no, we're going to do it my way. So he's really trying to build it to the culture and to obviously to fit this conference. And we saw him do that at Temple. I'm intrigued to see, you know, they're not going to be a no huddle team anymore either. We're going to see a huddle for the first time. Where, you know, the quarterback will be talking to the players in the huddle, where for the last several years, I can't remember the last time Nebraska ran up. I mean, Mike Riley's teams did some huddles, but it just hasn't been the norm.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting, too. There's new rules, too, that will quicken the game up in terms of when the clock stops and does not stop. You're looking at probably two teams that would like to run the football tonight. This game could be under 3 hours. We shall see. Hey, before we get in any further, Sean, I want to ask you about volleyball. And you guys can ask questions. We have Tyler White standing by, and he will take your questions, and we'll ask answer away for the next 25 minutes or so. But I want to get you your take on the volleyball last night. We were obviously up here last night with the football team. It was amazing to see the outpouring of support at the local establishments watching the volleyball, and then seeing the reaction around the country. I'm sure you got texts from people. I got texts from people all over the country, just blown away at 92-003, and it dominated. It was one of the major stories on SportsCenter, even right now before we came down here. What kind of impact do you think this had moving forward?
Well, it just showcased what the strength of Nebraska is, the fans. Mm-hmm. And you can say you have the best fans in the country, but you don't, because Nebraska does. Mm-hmm. And nights like last night, you can't argue that. Right. I mean, they set a world record for the largest crowd to ever attend a women's sporting event. And I think when Trev Alberts, when he put this idea together, and the minute they saw that, hey, you know what, we could adjust our capacity with field seating and additional seating, we can get this record. Garth Brooks basically had a crowd like that in for his show. And once they knew that was in their sights, they were able to put together a plan to get the record. And there's so, I mean, this is so much value to Nebraska now to say, we have a world record for the largest crowd to ever attend a women's sporting event. Larger than a Women's World Cup soccer game in the Rose Bowl. Larger than a European Champions League soccer match in Spain. It's just unbelievable. And now it's like, what's next?
Yeah, yeah.
What's the next thing?
Well, and you got to believe it made an impact on so many of the young kids watching yesterday. And now they have something to dream for. Maybe they'll do it again. Who knows? I can't see this being an every year thing. But, you know, maybe a couple of years down the road, they'll try it again and maybe try to break the 92-003. It was just pretty amazing to see from our perspective, knowing where we're at and seeing what was happening last night. It was a magical night. And I know it wasn't perfect. I know that, you know, I've heard some complaints, some minor ones, but man, you can't argue with what they were able to pull off.
Yeah, I mean, you're going to have concession issues and things in that region. There's just a lot of people that want to eat and drink.
Right.
There's only so many stands to go to. There's only so many bathrooms. I mean, they don't get crowds of the football games that packed.
Right.
I mean, that was
because you had people on the field.
That was Garth Brooks level packed, and that was as crowded as I've ever seen Memorial Stadium.
All right, let's get back to football. Let's talk about this game today. I want to ask you about the running back situation. Gabe Irvin obviously won that job in camp. What do you expect out of Gabe Irvin?
Well, he's big. I mean, you look at Gabe Irvin, he's 220, 25 pounds now. He's really added to his body. I think when he gets his shoulders squared up, I whistled there.
That was nice.
I don't even know how to whistle, but I did that. But when he gets his shoulders squared up and goes downhill, can he get Nebraska on, keep him on schedule? I mean, that's the key. And, you know, his career high for carries, Andy, is 12.
Okay.
We think that's going to be shattered tonight, no questions asked. And his career high for yardage in the game is 60.
Okay.
So, you know, his body of work is not that much.
Right.
12 and 60 are his best numbers he's ever put up at Nebraska. You know, you would think tonight he's going to push 20 carries and have a shot at 100 yards.
Yeah, I was going to ask you this. We're going to play a game called over-under, and I'm going to set a line. You take me the over-under, and I think I know the answer to this one. I set the over-under on Gabe Irvin's rushing attempts at 16 and a half. You're going over that.
I'll say he's getting about 18, 19.
Yeah.
20 is a lot.
Yeah. Now, you did say he wanted to be the bell cow, but, you know.
What's the over-under on Anthony Grant tonight?
Well, that's a great question.
Is it 10?
I was thinking maybe 6.5.
A lot of it will depend on how Gabe Irvin runs.
Yeah.
If they struggle with his style and don't get much going, because all of a sudden then you have to maybe change up the pace. And Ramir Johnson, you know, is battling kind of a soft tissue deal. So what will his availability? And tonight, Andy, at 5 o'clock, the first ever Big Ten availability report will be coming out. So Matt Rhule will have to kind of list the health status of his team. Not something he's real wild about.
Yeah.
And essentially, it's a gambler's report.
Well, yeah, and people who've been around the NFL for years, it's just your injury report. And, you know, some schools have done it. Wisconsin's done it for years. But now it's mandatory. All Big Ten teams will have to produce an availability report 2 hours prior to kickoff. And that will tell us, will Teddy Prohaska be available? Will Marcus Washington be available? Will Nick Henrich? Will, you know, Ramir Johnson? So, from a media perspective and a fan's perspective, I think it's a benefit. But I know the coaches like to keep this up close to the vest and keep people guessing. PJ Fleck said as much on his news conference earlier in the week that he's going to wait until the very last minute. He wasn't wild about it either. Do we have a question, Tyler?
I have a question.
All right, Tyler White.
It's from Rob in Papillion.
Rob in Papillion. Hey, Rob.
How much grace does Matt Rhule get from us Husker fans this season? Do you think people will be quickly judgmental, or will they give him time? Will the same go for you sports scribes?
Well, that's a wonderful question, Rob. Thanks for chiming in. Well, what do you think? The honeymoon period is alive and well for Matt Rhule. How long does this thing last?
I think his ability of how he treats people,
yeah,
and his approach is going to help him. You know, Scott Frost, Bo Pelini type guys, they didn't have great approaches with the fans at times or the media.
Right.
So you kind of lose. Like Tim Miles, one of the all-time greats. Like his style bought him time. Fred Hoiberg, very likable guy. I think that's part of it. You know, how much does this fan base believe in the new coach? If they're even if they're losing, they still have that belief that hey, he can get this thing turned around over time. But you know, Matt Rhule knows he's got to get it going here. I mean, look at the schedules, how tough they're going to get.
Right.
And you know, what does that do to expectations? Does your expectation level change when you know Nebraska's going to be playing 5 or 6 ranked conference games a year?
Yeah, it's the first time since 1995 that the Huskers are opening with back-to-back road games. Obviously tonight in Minnesota, and then a week from Saturday against Coach Prime at Colorado. So we'll get a pretty good gauge on what this team is going to be all about. But I really don't think that we're going to get a true gauge of what this team's identity is until about midway through. And I kind of circled the October 6th game in Illinois. After that game, it'll be halfway through the schedule. We have that bye week. And I think we can really understand where this team is and where this team's going, because Matt Rhule has said time and time again he wants his team to improve as the year goes on and play their best football late in the year. So that's why I thought it was interesting, a totally different approach than what we had the last few years, where so much was put into the game in Dublin, so much was put into that game at Illinois. And when it didn't work out for Nebraska, it was like, oh my goodness,
you
almost
over.
Had the season's over with the approach. You heard it. Matt Rhule said, you know, obviously they want to win every game, but he knows that this is one of 12. I thought it was a unique perspective going into this opener.
Yeah, and this game, it's big. They're all big. I mean, but if they lose this game, I think Matt Rhule's going to have a pretty even keel about him. And I truly don't think he knows what to expect.
Right.
He's like, we just need to play some games.
Right.
And that's why, like, predicting this game, you know, we do our predictions on Husker Online, and most of us, all of us, took Minnesota essentially in kind of a close win. And a lot of it's just because we don't know who Nebraska is right now, but we do know the team that they have been. And I think you don't want to believe they're a new team until you see it. So it's hard to say they could win this game, or you're going to pick them if you're trying to be objective.
Right. Reverse psychology. I want you to know that I picked against Nebraska, and I never do. I'm always Mr. Pro-Nebraska, but I'm trying to go reverse psychology today, so I didn't pick Nebraska.
Everybody essentially had a similar pick. Minnesota win with a Nebraska cover.
Right. I think I was the only outlier. I think I had 8. They're going to score in my prediction. We'll get to it later. I don't want to spoil it. All right. Let's get back to over-under. How about this? Over-under Jeff Sims rushing yards, 59.5. And now I'm making these up, by the way. You can't really bet on these. I'm just, you know, come on. This is entertainment purposes only.
That's
59.5. You go over for Jeff Sims or under, and what does that tell you about Nebraska if he goes over?
The college game's hard because they count the sacks.
Yeah,
on.
Yeah. See, it's all part of the number.
Tricky.
I'll say under.
You want to under?
Because there might be a couple sacks in there.
Well, here's the deal. If he goes over, what does that say? What does that tell you?
That they're not running the ball the game.
Yeah.
And so here's the answer, my question to you. 3rd and 7. If
right.
you can't get your receivers open or protect, and your only play is Jeff Sims going.
Mm-hmm.
They get the first down, but that's not a long, sustaining recipe to win
Correct.
Games.
Correct.
They've got to come up with execution up front at the receiver position, because you don't want Jeff Sims having to run to get every 3rd and 7.
Yeah, I don't think anybody wants to see the Adrian Martinez offense where, hey, it's 3rd down, Adrian, go make a play. Hey, it's 3rd down, it's 3rd and 8, Jeff, run around. And hopefully you get the and hopefully you avoid hits, because you know how that ended up. I want to ask you about wide receivers too. Like, that's been one of the more unique competitions, And Matt Rhule, I thought, was an interesting comment when he said, hey, you know, if these freshmen don't play, it's not a huge deal. They want to bring them along slowly. What does that say in terms of what do you expect from that depth chart and that position group tonight?
Jalen Lloyd and Malachi Coleman are probably the two that could play. I know Malachi's here because I saw him last night. But Jaden Doss was probably set to play until he hurt his hand, and he's got a cast on, so he's not out here. So I think there's the speed element that those guys can bring. And when Xavier Betts left, they all of a sudden lost that deep threat they had. And so who is that? Can any of these other guys, Alex Bullock, Marcus Washington, some other guys, Marcus Washington been battling some injuries in camp. And Billy Kemp, I think most people just think he's an underneath, kind of a possession type guy, not a deep threat like Betts. So that's my thing. If these other guys can't give them a deep threat, that's maybe when you see a Malachi Coleman or Jalen Lloyd have to come in to run deep. And Tommy Hill, there's been some grumblings that he could still play both sides of the ball. Matt Rhule's done that in his coaching career.
That's interesting. And plus,
I do have a question.
I will follow up in a second, and we'll get to this in a minute, but don't forget about the tight ends. Huge part of the pass.
Thomas Fedoni. First time we've seen him play.
Finally!
Yes. Bonner and Borkature. So these guys are going to have to play a big role. All right, Tyler, another question.
I got a couple questions Doug. So we're going to do – he's got one about offense, and since we're talking about the offense, we'll go with that one first. He says, Wildcat formation, will we see that at all?
Whoa.
Satterfield has done that in his past.
What do you think?
I mean, Jeff Sims can kind of run a Wildcat. That's the thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, but maybe Heinrich Harburg. What about Heinrich Harburg coming in
for a goal line?
That's a great, great point. Like, Matt Foster is on board saying Heinrich Harburg is going to have multiple touchdowns.
Just a Harburg truck formation where he just comes
in. And he's goes... built where, and we were talking about this on the ride, a lovely ride up 35 yesterday. It is 35, right?
I think so.
Yeah. That if you get to the goal line, you put a goal line package in for Harburg, because if you're going to have a quarterback take hits, you probably want your number two or 2A.
Like 240.
And he's built, right? So if you can take some of those hits away from Jeff Sims, why not have a goal line package with Heinrich Harburg? I think that's an excellent point.
Well, he's one of the fastest guys on the team already.
Yeah.
Just his explosion and speed. So there's possibility. I mean, that's the guy that I could see like a Wildcat.
Yeah. All right. What else?
The other question from Doug. What would you say is the strengths and weaknesses of the Nebraska defense this year?
All right, strengths and weaknesses or challenges on defense. Strength, I think they're pretty good at linebacker and they're pretty good on the back end, don't you think?
I just think the strength is the core of veterans overall.
Yeah,
they've got a good point. They've got eight of those guys in single-digit jerseys right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and then so you go on the D-line, Nash Huttmacher, Ty Robinson. That's two dudes. You got three at linebacker, Nick Henrich, Luke Reimer, and John Bullock. Then on the back end, you got Isaac Gifford, Quentin Newsom, and Deshaun Singleton. So that's eight guys there. And then that's not even, Malcolm Hartsook. I mean, they've got a good 11 or 13 guys.
Right.
The question is, do they have enough after that? And I think that's where, on the D-line, do they have enough? Do they have a guy in this pass rush that can get more than four or five sacks in a season?
Right.
That's just been Nebraska post-Randy Gregory. They haven't had a lot of sack artists.
Who do you think right now, I'm asking you, on 8:31, who's going to lead this team in sacks? What would your answer be?
You would like it to be MJ Sherman.
Yeah.
But he's not a black shirt. So,
did that surprise you?
A little bit, but they love Chief Borders, and I think those guys are going to rotate pretty equally.
Right, and I don't think because the guy didn't have the black shirt doesn't mean he's not going to play a role, because I do think they only handed out 11. So, I think MJ Sherman is really a key component of this defense. But you would say Sherman then?
And Jamari Butler, he might have been the starter at the Jack if he wasn't hurt.
Right.
But Ty Robinson, Elijah Judy, they've said, is one of the best pass rushers they have, but he's he's inconsistent in other areas. So there's a lot of candidates that could rise up in that role. Tonight will not be a good measurement of that, though. Minnesota does a lot of play actions, a lot of RPO. So, it's not like you're going to see traditional 3-5, 7-step drops out of the Gophers.
Yeah, and I've been practicing all offseason on Ethan Calacmanis, so I've got that down pat. I remember last year when they came back to win behind Calacmanis, I couldn't say his name in the post game.
I still can't say it.
So. You were like Chris Fowler and Dominican Sue.
Big Sue.
Right.
I mean, it was like, and then he just goes, and there's Mr. Sue again.
There you go, right. Like, yeah, Calacmanis.
I'm just like Andy and Pontevedra.
Oh, yeah. I still can't say that name. Yeah. Wonderful resort town. All right,
I'm probably saying it wrong right now. Michael asks about the freshman starting kicker, Tristan Albano.
That's a great question. Let's go. Let's go special teams, Tristan Albano. No surprise he won the thing, but you never know the battle. But you just never know until you go through it. And he won it fair and square, didn't he? Right?
Yeah, and I think they wanted an extended battle to test the kid, see what he can do. I think in their mind, they saw the spring of Timmy Bleak Road. It was not a good spring.
Right.
And we saw the spring game, but they saw more. And I was told it wasn't a great spring. Bleak Road is limited overall athletically, his leg talent. I mean, he can put it through the pipes, 40 on in, maybe 45 on in, but he just doesn't have the leg talent. I mean, Albano's got a big league leg.
Yeah.
He's as talented of a kicker to come out of Nebraska in a long, long time. There's been some good ones. As we know, Brett Maher and Alex Henry and then even Greg Zuerlein.
Yeah.
It's funny, Maher and Zuerlein, they're still kicking. They're pretty much neighbors in Lincoln.
Maher had a tough week, though.
Who's he with now?
He was with the Broncos, and then Sean Payton picked up, traded for Will Lutz, and then he cut.
So he's back.
I think he's looking for work.
He'll get a job.
Zuerlein's in New York Jets.
And he's doing the hard knocks.
I coached kindergarten basketball this winter with Greg Zuerlein.
Did you?
Yeah, he's got five little kids.
Do you think, what do you see kicking being a factor today? Could be a little bit windy.
Yeah, and I think that's a good point. The kicking will be a factor because I think it's going to be low scoring. And so every point is going to count. So, you know, you just hope you get some confidence under Tristan. Not that he lacks it, because he certainly does not. He's a terrific kicker. But you hope that, you know, maybe the first attempt is maybe a 35-yarder right down the middle rather than a 55 on the hash. You know what I mean? So, you know, but I do think kicking will play a role.
That point total is 45, 46.
46.5, which, I think. I'll double check.
That's an extremely low number.
Yes.
I mean,
especially for college.
Like, you just don't see a Nebraska number that low.
Yep. But I think that's where we're headed with this team and regime, because
And the clock rule.
Yeah.
The clock rule is going to lower scoring college
football. Well, I'm sorry, it's 42.5.
I was going to say, I was
42
like,
and a half.
Like, that is as
that's
low
as low as a number.
I mean, that's a rock fight.
Yeah, 42.5, that's the over-under for tonight's game.
I didn't know the Iowa Hawkeyes are playing in this game.
I know, yeah. And, you know, what we didn't talk about was Buscini. So he's got a...
Field position matters. Like,
yeah.
When the number's like that, the punting, the kickoff special teams play, and you're going to see a lot of starters from Nebraska on special teams. That unit of kickoff coverage, punt coverage, it's predominantly black shirt players.
Right.
And that's what they want. And they're going to win this game, if they do, in those types of areas. They've got to play good special teams and win field position battles, because if points are truly going to be at a premium like the guys in the desert are predicting, which they tend to know more than us.
Yeah, they do. And the other thing is, I just saw on ESPN before coming down, is that their FPI, their prediction is Minnesota has a 67% chance of winning. Conversely, Nebraska, 33% chance of winning. We'll see. All right, Tyler, what else?
I have a question from Brent. It's a very serious question. He said, where are your red shirts at?
Oh, my goodness.
You're wearing black.
You know what?
You're
it's funny. I wore this.
Blue.
I'll fess up. I wore this yesterday, and I didn't want to burn the red shirt because I'm wearing the red shirt tonight. So what's your excuse?
Well, I'm going to change.
Yeah.
So we're going to go to lunch.
Yeah.
My family and I, after we get done doing this, then now that we're done with this, we don't really have to get to the stadium as early as we normally would.
Right. Well, but we do, but you know.
Your shows. So I'm going to come back and change up your lunch, then we're going to go down.
We'll probably need you for live shots at 5 and 6. But
am I on 5 or 6?
If you want, yeah. Hey, we've got to set the. This is our meeting.
Welcome to the meeting.
Yeah. Well, I'll take care of the four. So,
another question.
Another question.
I got another question from Jeff. He's like, has there been any discussion about Satterfield at South Carolina? Like, didn't seem to be popular there, is what Jeff is saying.
He had his moments at South Carolina. It didn't really end as greatly as people would have wanted.
Well, they beat Tennessee.
Yeah.
I mean,
but he kind of had a up and down in terms of the fans, that their perspective of him. But, you know, a new chapter here, and I think he starts fresh, and he's been pretty impressive. It's, you know what I've been impressed with, and not just Satterfield, but the unity of message, you know, they're all, it's amazing how much they're all aligned
in
messaging.
Two pros, too. I mean, you look at both these coordinators. I mean, just they have a very professional approach. Mm-hmm. Satterfield's is all business, and you can tell he doesn't get too high or too low. Will he be up in the box? I mean, I would assume.
I thought somebody said he was going to be on the field.
Rule said that both his coordinators like to call plays from the field.
Yes. But he wouldn't like to do it that way. Rule?
Right. Yeah, so I'm expecting to see Satterfield on the field.
Right. Yeah, so here's a question for you. So give me a guy on offense and defense, and it's not a pick to click, but just give me a guy that intrigues you because you haven't seen a lot of. Like, what really, who are you going to look at? Where are your eyes going to gravitate towards on that first couple series to say, okay, let me get a good look at, see where this guy's at?
God, there's so many. I mean, the quarterback, take Jeff Sims out.
Yeah, take it, yeah.
We're all intrigued, but just Billy Kemp, and even Alex Bullock, like, is he really a Big Ten receiver?
Yeah,
or is he just there
great point.
By default?
Right. I'm curious about Fedoni. I mean, everybody's been waiting for this guy to play. And from all accounts, he's had one heck of a fall camp. And now it's go time for him. The guy has worked his tail off to get back into this position. And we'll see if he's a difference maker, which we all thought coming up.
Well, and John Bullock, let's throw the other Bullock.
And that the other one, I was going to say, defensively, you say John Bullock. I kind of want to see Chief Borders, but MJ Sherman is the guy that I really want to see what he's able to do.
And I heard all August, everyone that went to scrimmages said, man, the defense is pretty good.
Yeah.
Now, that can scare you because that might mean your offense is pretty bad.
Now, here's the thing. Like, you know, the 3-3-5 is predicated on pre-snap looks and what you're showing, what you're not showing, and then what you ultimately do in terms of lining up and who you're sending. So how will that translate, and how will that survive a Big Ten rushing attack is my big question. Our team's going to be able to run the football against Nebraska.
I mean, it's like a puzzle. I think each week Tony White puts a new puzzle together with how he's going to attack. Like, you can't play Minnesota the same as you would play Louisiana Tech. I think you have to adjust your pieces, adjust your looks, and Tony White will move pieces around. I've seen him present, and he likes to put his best players on your worst players. So that might mean moving MJ Sherman or Chief Borders over a left guard if the left guard is the worst guy. And they'll create matchups to let their playmakers make plays. So I think that's the beauty of this Tony White system, is it's very versatile, it's very flexible. I don't think it's just all 3-3-5.
Right.
I mean, I think there's going to be a lot of...
Sometimes it's going to be 4-2.
Yeah.
Or, you know, 5 or 6-1.
You can't be stubborn and only run that. And he played against... I mean, he wasn't the coach for the bowl game, but the 3-3-5 system played against Minnesota. He helped Minnesota or Syracuse get ready for a bowl game against Minnesota.
And the guy who's running that is now on staff at Minnesota.
Is he a co-coordinator?
I don't know if he's an analyst or a co-coordinator.
I think he's a co-coordinator.
But that's something to keep in mind, too. So there's some Syracuse flavor to both sides of the football tonight. And I also, before we get to another question, I also think that Blaze Gunnarsson, he's really taken a step in camp. I'm curious to see how he takes the step tonight when it matters. And Cam Lenhart, I mean, that's a guy who's a true freshman, going to play big boy snaps tonight. And I think that's pretty amazing.
I mean, Deshaun Singleton's another one.
Deshaun Singleton is a guy who people just rave about.
They thought last year he was going to maybe have a shot to beat out Miles Farmer, and it just never happened. And now he's here.
Well, it's interesting, too, because some of the highlights I saw, you know, getting ready for this trip, Minnesota, Deshaun Singleton was on the field getting work last year. So I'm sure that he's got that chip on his shoulder. Also, before we get to that, Minnesota natives, which we haven't really talked a whole lot about.
It's a good story this
week. It's a great storyline. Omar Brown, Bryce Benhart, and who am I forgetting?
Emmett Johnson.
Emmett Johnson, the freshman. And he's going to play a role on
kick return.
Yeah.
Omar Brown from Minneapolis. Emmett Johnson from Minneapolis. Bryce Benhart from like a suburb area.
Yep.
Question, and it's once again from Rob.
All right, Rob, way to chime in, my friend. Caring
is. Which is more valued on the team, a black shirt or a single digits number?
Ooh, what do you say? Well, single digits, there's only 10,
I would say single
them,
digit
10 of them.
Because the players on the team vote for you.
Right.
And that's the ultimate sign of respect when your peers around you choose you to be one of the toughest, baddest dudes in the program.
Right. Plus it includes offense too. You know, so and there's just fewer offense.
It's 8-2 defense, offense. Now there's the technicality that Ethan Piper could be one, but he can't wear a single digit number.
Right. And that's the only position group that you're not allowed to wear single digits in this day and age. So, yeah, I'll be interested to see if they do something. You know, I'm just suggesting maybe he wears a sticker or a patch.
Is the single digit number, is that just like a funny gimmick, or is it taken really seriously?
Oh, I think it's serious. No, I think it's serious. I think Nebraska, the players have really bought into the single digit stuff. I mean, it is a point of pride to wear a single digit. And, you know, you kind of felt it during camp when Newsom didn't get his six, that he really wanted to get his six, or Ty Robinson really wanted to get that nine.
And nobody took that six.
Yeah, and people knew that, like, that was Quinton's. Like, yeah. He's going to play hard, and he's going to earn that six.
Like, so think if Billy Kemp, the first, like, I'm taking
six.
Hey,
brother, I got first pick. I'm taking a six. How about that?
But everyone showed him the respect. Like, we want him to have this number.
And Newsom is one of those guys who quite honestly could have tested the waters from the NFL, and he chose to come back. And I thought it was interesting too, as we start wrapping this thing up. It was interesting to hear Luke Reimer this week when he talked about how he had a meeting with Coach Rule right after he arrived and said, hey, we don't want year three or four, we're going to be gone by then. The urgency, we want year one. And Matt Rule's like, yeah, we have the pieces in place where year one doesn't have to be what he's done year one in the past. And that was kind of go one win or zero wins at Temple and Baylor. He thinks that this team is talented enough to win some games this week. I thought that was pretty telling.
And what is that definition of win some games?
Yeah.
Is it six? Is it seven? Is it eight or more? I mean, like, I think most people in the camp, just get to a dang bowl game so Andy and I can get sunburned in Florida for a week.
Yeah, drink out of Red Solo cups. You know, it's funny, we were talking, again, on our long, you learn a lot about an individual on a six-hour drive from Iowa into Minnesota. But we had mentioned, remember how absurd when Bill Moos said, well, we got to get to six, and everybody lost their collective minds a couple years ago
between
media days. Now, it's funny how we've evolved, and everybody's kind of in lockstep, like, just get to a darn bowl game. And I think that's the first step in what hopefully will be a new foundation of Husker football. All right, quick picks to click. Ready? You want to do picks to click? Who's your pick to click? Offense.
My pick to click.
No Jeff Sims. Can't pick Jeff Sims.
My pick to click is Billy Kemp.
Billy Kemp. I'm going to go Thomas Fedoni. Tyler?
Borkature.
See? He is sneaky under the radar. He's like, all right, how about defense? Give me a defense.
I'm going to go Isaac Gifford, number two, in the single-digit jersey.
Ooh, all right. What do you got?
I like to go Hartzog. He's my guy.
Malcolm Hartzog. Yeah. All right. I'm gonna go Luke Reimer. He's had a heck of a camp. He's going to make some big plays tonight. So, all right. Game's at 7. It's on Fox. We will have post-game coverage. It could land during our 10 o'clock show because of the timing, new rules. It could be a quick game. So, but stay with KETV at 10, and then we'll obviously have post-game posted on KETV.com following the game. For Tyler White, for Sean Callahan, who's ready to go to lunch with his family, I'm Andy Kenny. Thanks for watching us. And it's the Huskers and